So I'm kind of, my name is Alvaro. I'm living in Switzerland. I was going to say I'm kind of getting deported because of this, because I'm delayed by 70 seconds. So that's not acceptable there. Anyway, this talk is about scaling applications with RabbitMQ. My name is Alvaro, as you can see there. Don't try to pronounce it. At Starbucks, they never can get my name, so. Anyway, I'm a developer advocate at Pivotal or RabbitMQ, depending on how you want to call that. I'm co-author of the book RabbitMQ in Action, creator of the simulator. I blog about the RabbitMQ internals, and I'm also on Twitter.
Weird.
I'm also on Twitter, and that's my email and GitHub. For some people that don't know what Pivotal is, I want to have a little explanation. There are two big companies in software, not only two. I'm going to mention two. This one is EMC, the other one is VMware. And VMware had a lot of companies that had acquired, like RabbitMQ and Cloud Foundry, and also was sponsoring the development of Redis and so on. And then EMC was owning Greenplum, Pivotal Labs, and some other companies. So these two companies got together and say, why don't we get a new company where we combine all these applications like RabbitMQ for message passing, Greenplum, and some other products they have for big data processing, then Cloud Foundry for deployment in the cloud, and so on and so forth. So they got the new company called Pivotal. So that's what that is. I get asked a lot, what is Pivotal? What has to do with Rabbit and so on? Well, that's the answer. And that's the book. You can go and acquire it. And the talk. This talk is about exploring what can be done with Rabbit and more what could be done, not how you do it. I believe most people in this conference, I don't know why I say most, but is smart enough to, that qualifier doesn't belong in the sentence. So I believe people in this conference is qualified to just go to the website, read tutorials, search online, and so on. So I don't like to waste your time just showing you this is the code, this is blah, 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 because that's not so interesting, I think. So first question, is anybody using Rabbit in production? Okay. 30,000 hands up for the record. So Rabbit is a multi-protocol messaging server. I will tell you what this is. Basically, you can talk to Rabbit in many protocols, like AMQP, Stomp, MQTT, and many more. It's open source under the Mozilla public license. Although this used to belong to VMware and now to Pivotal, we are not charging for Rabbit, so I'm not here to sell anything. Also, I don't have a tie, so you can trust me. It's a polyglot messaging system in many senses because you can code against Rabbit with many languages, and you could extend RabbitMQ with many languages as well. It's written in Erlang OTP. This is the part where I do the Church of Erlang introduction. You're welcome to join us every Sunday. We pray for the gods of Scandinavia. And Erlang is a... Why should I even care that it's written in Erlang? The thing with Erlang is that it's a language that was written for highly available applications, for message passing, for concurrency. And all the stuff that is baked into the language is stuff that the RabbitMQ developers don't need to implement. Less code, less bugs, basically. That's like the long story short. We are not in an Erlang conference, so next. Multi-protocol. As I said before, there is AMQP, MQTT, and Stomp. The default one is AMQP. It stands for Advanced Messaging Queuing Protocol. MQTT something something telemetry something, don't ask me. it's come from IBM, but it's also an open protocol. And Stomp is also open, and it's a text-based protocol, very similar to, not similar, but simple as the Redis protocol, where you can just read it and see what's going on the network. And actually at CERN, for example, for the Large Hadron Collider, they use STOMP. MQTT is very good, it's a very good protocol for small devices where you have low power and power and battery constraints. Facebook uses it for the iOS chat application. They're using MQTT. And then NQP is used everywhere. Somebody is using Rabbit is basically using NQP mostly. But you can combine. You can send messages and with MQTT consumed from NQP and so on. This is not, you can mix and match. And that's a blog post written by a colleague that explained when you will need one or the other. He likes MQTT a lot, so be careful. So I say polyglots. Java, woo. Where are the boos coming from? We have a client for Java in Rabbit. It's an official client and is maintained by the RabbitMQ developers. There are Node clients. One of them also created by one of the Rabbit guys. There are Erlang clients. Most of the plugins and extensions to Rabbit are based on the Erlang client, so it's a very well-tested and supported client. The Java one is the fastest one. So if you want to test performance of Rabbit, I would advise using the Java client, because what are you testing, the speed of a client or the speed of the actual broker? Then the PHP client is maintained by the guy giving a talk today at 4 p.m. at Miami Sunshine PHP. Blame that guy. That I don't know him. There is a Ruby client also maintained by one of the RabbitMQ developers. There are .NET, which is also official client. And there is even Haskell, for example, to name a few. You can also use it in Clojure, many other languages, including that guy. the person writing this blog actually is a Hewlett Packard engineer. I'm not saying Hewlett Packard is using Rabbit, but they have this thing. They publish also a Java high availability client that can detect a server going down and some server coming up. So you make the connection. So there are very lot of interesting stuff in that blog. User of Rabbit, Instagram is using Rabbit, indeed.com, Telefonica, which is like the telco in Spain, and they probably own every other telco in South America. The other ones are owned by Carlos Slim in Mexico, so that's like the two telcos in the world. Then Mercado Libre, I know if this is popular in the state, but it's like the eBay of South or Latin America, so you can imagine with all the population in Uruguay, we are kind of killing this website, 3 million people. Then the NHS in England, they are using Rabbit as well. Mozilla, I don't know if Brandon is here, but Brandon Savage, he wrote a blog post about using Rabbit because they are using it in a project in Mozilla where they track when the browser crashes. So the NSA of browser crashing is actually Rabbit, because every crash of your Firefox will go through Rabbit. And recently, it's not there, but the New York Times had a very cool write-up on how they are using Rabbit in a very big distributed architecture. Because every browser connection to the New York Times actually opens a WebSocket connection that goes to Rabbit. So that's pretty big deployment. There where you can get Rabbit, it works in all these platforms. When we chose Rabbit back in the days when I was working in China, this was one of the reasons, because we had developers that were using Windows, Mac, or Unix, and then everybody could actually have a setup. This was pre-Vagrant days, so it was interesting. So what is RabbitMQ? What can you do with Rabbit? This is a small demo I want to do with the simulator. You can access the simulator there if you want. It's the less responsive website on the net today, so if you want to see that in action. And that's basically the simulator. What is that? In Rabbit, or in messaging, what you have is that you have a producer of data that wants to send stuff to a consumer. And of course, you need an address. You cannot just say, I have this for you, but you need some way to address the person or the consumer. So the producer will connect to that thing, which in Rabbit is called exchange, and will send data. As you can see there, nothing happened. The message stopped at the exchange. That's because we don't have a queue. When we bind a queue to an exchange, the messages will start to get routed, and because there is no consuming, they are getting queued on the broker or whatever. And that's where the consumer enters the picture, subscribes to the queue, and start getting messages. If you want to scale this setup, you can add another consumer or even another one, subscribe all of them to the queue, and then send messages, and RabbitMQ will do the automatic round robin for you. That's the most basic setup of Rabbit. One question you may have is like, why do I even need an exchange when I can just send messages to a queue? The thing with the exchange, this analogy, I know it doesn't work in the States, sorry, but in Switzerland there are trains, and people used to go to trains and use trains for transport everywhere. So when you go to buy tickets at the train station, you have like a thingy there where you press a button saying, I want local tickets or international tickets. You get a ticket number, which will put you in a queue. Basically, that thingy there is the exchange routing you where you actually want to go and putting you in a queue, in an effective queue, waiting for a cashier to be available that will serve your request. So with the exchange, you abstract the routing part from the actual destination of the message. You can do things like having a queue. Let's say this one is int for international, and this one is local. Then when a customer arrives, you can have a routing key when you publish the message, and the message will go only to the local queue. But if the client, let's say, came with an international request, it will go only to the international queue. That's because this is a direct exchange. There are many types of exchanges. I don't know if you can see in the back, but this is direct, fan-out, and topic. There are even more. What that is telling us is the type of algorithm that RabbitMQ will choose when it has to route messages. A direct exchange will check on the binding key, this stuff here, local or int, with what you sent as a routing key. By default, there are empty routing keys. That's why at the beginning, the messages were going everywhere, because I was sending messages with empty routing keys, and the queues were bound with empty routing keys. But now that I'm specifying one, the direct exchange will route messages depending on that. But let's say you want to do something like publish subscribe, similar to how Twitter works. You want to send a message, and this message to be broadcast to every queue that you have bound to that exchange. You can select the fan-out exchange type, and you can see the routing keys, they disappear, so they don't care anymore or don't matter anymore. So we get a fan-out behavior. Of course, you can have more than one exchange in the system. Actually, one betting company in England, I remember one of their guys reporting over 1 million exchanges in their system. So it scales pretty well, that part of Rabbit. Okay, so then another one is topic exchange. This one is pretty advanced, because by default, it just works like the direct exchange, nothing new. But let's say we are sending logs to Rabbit. And here we are tagging the logs like the server where the log was originating, dot application, dot error, info, whatever. So I can say, I want a queue getting messages from server one like application one, module one info, for example. I change that. And then I can publish the message. Nothing so fancy. But let's say I want a queue that will get messages from every server. I don't care what the server is. The key here is that all these routing keys are words separating by dots. So in this topic exchange, you can add like a star there, and that will tell Rabbit that you that this queue doesn't care which server originates the message as long as it's application one, module one, info. So if I send this message, it goes to both. But if I change the routing key on the message to server two, it only goes to that queue. Then let's say you want a queue also that will get all the errors that happened on the system, no matter the server, doesn't matter the application, and so on. So you can use the hash or octothorf, and the messages will go there. And if I have application two, it will only go to that queue. So the star stands for one word. It's like a wildcard for only one word. And the hash is for zero or more words. They are not regexes. Any questions up to here? OK. So something I usually get asked after the talk, so I will answer it now. Is the simulator is written in JavaScript using processing, which is like a visual tool which resembles Java syntax. And the creator of jQuery did the port, so it also works on JavaScript. With this tool, you could also import and export data from Rabbit. So if you want to debug what's happening on your application, you can import everything. It will be drawn there, and you can add a consumer, send the message, and see if, where the message is going based on the routing keys you are using. With export, you could send that to Rabbit, so you can design your topology, put it there, export, and so on. And this two-player thingy, you can actually write documentation with this, not Lorem Ipsum like this one. But as an example, let's say your docs for how you're using Rabbit have this kind of thingy. The simulator can be exported and just be in player mode only, or stuff like that, and so on. I know of companies that when they board new members to the team, they're using the simulator to explain how they use Rabbit. So when you start Rabbit, what do you get out of the box? No message loss. This is a very bold statement. Not in bold, but it's quite bold. What does it mean? Unless your data center sets on fire, there shouldn't be message loss. When you use Rabbit, you can tell Rabbit to persist queues. That is, if the server restarts, the queue should still be there. You can tell Rabbit to persist messages, which is not the same. You can have a persistent queue with non-persistent messages that you can mix that. Because AMQP as a protocol was made primarily for the finance world where they need speed. So everything by default is non-persistent and as fast as possible. So as I said, persistent messages. You have publisher confirms. This is an extension to the protocol made by Rabbit, where whenever you send a message, if you really need to know that the broker took responsibility for the message, Rabbit can send you a NAC, an acknowledgement back to the publisher telling it this message arrived. You really need to make sure that you need that, because this kind of defeats the concept of messaging where everything is asynchronous, where a publisher doesn't know where it's sending the data. It just knows that you have an exchange where you put the data in. And then if there are subscribers, that message will go somewhere or not. So really, really, this is a very handy feature when you need to be absolutely sure that the message got written to disk. But be careful if you just jump to say, I want to use that, because better check your architecture to see if really what you need. There is message acknowledgement. This is from the other side. As a consumer, you can tell Rabbit, I'm done processing this message, delete it from the queue. By default, this is not the default behavior. Rabbit will just send the message and forget about the message, unless when you subscribe to the queue, you tell Rabbit, I will acknowledge every message. Since acknowledging every message could be like a potential bottleneck, you can batch acknowledge messages, for example. But what this will do is, like, if a consumer crashes while it was processing a message, that message will go back to Rabbit and will be sent to a different consumer. There are also mirror queues. So if you want to have high availability with Rabbit, you can just set the queues to be mirrored in your cluster, and then Rabbit will take care of distributing the messages and the acknowledgments and the consumers and so on. And there is message ordering. I've seen a lot of tweets and links and whatnot, or complaints saying that Rabbit doesn't have message ordering. Rabbit does have message ordering. The only moment where you won't get messages in order is if a consumer crashes before acting the message will be put back in the queue in the same place where it was. But if a previous message got already processed by another consumer in that period of time, I mean, there is no magic. That's called physics, or I don't know what's the actual part of maybe special relativity. I don't know, but there is no way to go around that. Maybe when we have quantum computers, I don't know. Also, the Rabbit has dead letter exchange. That means, let's say you have a poison message, that is a message that for some reason cannot be processed by your consumer. For example, your database is down, or some API you need to make a call is down, and so on. You can recheck the message. Instead of acting the message, you can tell Rabbit, no, I won't process this message. And then the message can be dead lettered, be going to an exchange, where then you will put a queue and handle those messages separately in a whatever fashion suits your application. There are alternate exchanges. Remember when I first put the exchange on the simulator, because I didn't have any queue bound to it, the messages were being dropped. So in that case, you can also have an alternate exchange saying this message can be routed there and handled separately. There are message and queue TTLs. So there can be times where your data or the requests are actually not relevant anymore. So you can mark each message with a particular TTL or a global per queue TTL. After that TTL has passed, that particular message won't be sent to a consumer. And when the message reaches the head of the queue, the message will be discarded or could also be dead lettered. There are consumer priorities. That means Rabbit can prioritize consumers over one consumer over another. That can be useful if you have a cluster that is not that the machines are not, they don't have the same power. So you can have machines with bigger CPUs than others, or you can have machines with more RAM than others. Depending on the task that you are doing, some machines will be better than the others. So you can tell the consumers running on those machines to have a higher priority than the ones in the slower CPUs, or the one with less RAM, slower network, slower hard drive, or whatever is worst or best. And there is also federation. Federation is a cool feature when you have a distributed data center and you want to replicate the data from server to server, then you can use federation. The clustering that Rabbit provides, the mirror queues, is meant for a local data center, and federation is meant for a distributed app. And there is also the shovel, which is quite similar to federation, but not quite. And this is the one that for distributed app is what the New York Times is using. They use the shovel. What's the company here that is taking care of all the salaries in the state, like the recipe? Yeah, ADP is using federation. And yeah, the New York Times using shovel, so fight. No. So from all these features I just mentioned, or some of them, you can read more in this blog post I wrote on the Rabbit blog, which is something interesting to know, because if you have, I mean, in software we have buffers everywhere. The network will be a buffer, your RAM will be a buffer, the CPU will have a buffer, and everywhere there will be buffers. If at some point one of those buffers gets overflown, we are in trouble. So we don't want this to happen. And Rabbit has many things that can let you prevent this from happening. There is no magic. The same way if your MySQL server runs out of hard drive, bad things will start happening. The same will be with Rabbit. In the case of Rabbit, if it runs out of hard disk or memory, it will just block publishers until the consumers are able to catch up with the amount of messages that are sitting in the queues. And in the next version of Rabbit, which should come out around April or March, the consumers will have higher priority in the system itself from publishers. When this makes sense, Rabbit will try to allocate more resources to send messages to consumers than from getting messages in from producers to prevent all these kind of problems. Oops. There is also a management plugin that comes right out of the box with Rabbit, which is this. So this is a plugin for Rabbit. It's like a single page application consuming data from an HTTP API that RabbitMQ exposes. This, I think. So there is an HTTP API that you can actually script against it. If you need to provision Rabbit servers, create queues, stuff like that. There are examples there how to use it and all the methods and stuff that are supported. So using this API, they built the management plugin where you can have an overview of all the resources being used in the system. You can check connections, channels. I mean, I'm not running anything right now. The exchanges that you have, as you can see, by default, there are all these exchanges specified by the protocol, which queues you have, and then like add new users, configure virtual host, federation, and so on. So yeah, that's the management API. And the interface you have. Questions so far? So, and to end the talk, I want to just show some examples of what can be done with Rabbit. The common one, or the first that comes to mind, probably is batch processing. Let's say we have a system that we need to generate XML. We need to distribute the data that is generated in a cluster. We need to have elasticity, the ability to add or remove workers, and no code changes. By no code changes, I mean that if I add new consumers from 1 to 100 or whatever, I don't need to change anything in the code. I can just fire a new consumer and it will just work. Believe it or not, this use case comes from a company I was working before. We were doing adult video distribution. You can tie the knots or connect the dots. And the thing is, every time there was a new movie, there was a new scene which had an XML description of the thingy. And for, yeah, XML is everywhere. Rule 36 of the internet. Don't Google rule 36 for here, please. So we had these XMLs describing the movies. And out of them, we need to generate trailers in different formats, take a screenshot from various parts of the video. And all this stuff had to be distributed in the cluster. I remember it was in New Jersey back then. Don't know now. Everything happens in Jersey, right? And all this stuff was orchestrated by a PHP 4 application using MySQL as a queue system. So you can see why I have some white hair and stuff like that, or gray hair. Anyway, the thing is that you wouldn't queue the job, then you, with the XML to do something, I mean, to that exchange, and then it will go to a queue, and the queue will just have workers. I mean, that's like most basic thing ever. I remember that system was limited to 4 workers. You need to go to the PHP code, like remove the hard-coded 4 there, put a 6, and yeah. And this is the code. So what is there? In Rabbit, we always get a connection with some parameters, like host, the port, the user, the password, and the virtual host in Rabbit. Virtual hosts are similar as in Apache. Every resource, like every queue and exchange, user, and so on, they live inside a virtual host. For each connection, you will get a channel. This is a way to multiplex the connections. In PHP, it doesn't make much sense, but in a language like Java or whatever you have threads, you can have many threads with channels sending and receiving data from Rabbit on the same TCP connection. That's the whole point of the channel. And everything that is state about what you're doing as a consumer or publisher is per channel. So your unact messages belong to one channel. The publisher confirms belong to a channel and so on. So it's a way to separate, have some separation in that area of using Rabbit. So with the channel, you will send a command to Rabbit, which is exchange declare, the name of the exchange, the type, and some options. Don't blame me for this. First, get me a language with name parameters like Python. Besides that, this API, I know, is not the best one, but it's used by tons of companies, or maybe not tons, but yeah, over 100,000 downloads in packages. So I cannot just go break the API because I don't like the API. That's trade-offs, as I was mentioning today in my other talk. Anyway, you get the exchange in Rabbit. The options are basically telling Rabbit durability of the exchange and stuff like that. Then you create a message with some content, and you can tell the content type of the message is text plain or XML or whatever. Rabbit doesn't care about what those fields are. And you will have like delivery mode 2. 2 means persistent, 1 means non-persistent. If you want to submit a pull request with a constant for that, I will merge it, but I never had the need for that. And then you can publish the message to the exchange, you close the channel, you close the connection. Of course, you don't need to send one message per connection. You can send thousands of messages in the same connection. That's obvious, but just in case. So this get the message into Rabbit, and then the consumer will create the connection, that's the same, will declare the exchange, declare the queue, bind the queue. So we tell this queue is bound to that exchange. We could have used a routing key, but we are not using routing keys in the publisher. We'd say basic consume, blah, 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 consumer callback, basically. That's what you care. You have a queue where you want to get the messages from, a consumer tag, you can let Rabbit, you can pass an empty string and let Rabbit create one automatically. And then among the options, you are telling Rabbit if you want to acknowledge messages and stuff like that. And then you just have a while loop waiting for messages. Any questions from here? Yes?
As far as like running the consumer code, are you saying like that would be one worker?
Yeah.
You wouldn't want to run that same consumer code all the time on the same machine on a different worker machine. See what I'm saying? Like,
yeah, so the question is if this worker code will run one per machine or they could be running many per machine, right? So this depends mostly on how many cores you have. We run many of these consumers in the same machine. That won't affect anything. Of course, at some point, they will have contention for the CPU, but that's that. Okay, so the question is how the consumer knows that the message that received is from him, or how Rabbit managed to send messages to one consumer or the other. First, this TCP connection belongs to this PHP process. That's the first part. You could have more than one callback. That's just a PHP callable. You can have more than one in the same script. But the key is that you say, I want, whenever a message arrives from this queue, call this callback. So I can have literally a new basic consume call here for a different queue. That the library will take care of sending the message to one callback or the other. And then for addressing one consumer versus another one in the same machine, that's basically the connection part of this. So another scenario is uploading pictures. The requirements as you want to upload the picture, you want to reward the user, like give some points, gamification, notify the friends of the user, and also resize the picture. And whenever you add a new feature, like let's say this was not planned, but then you need to resize pictures, you don't want to do any code changes. You just have to drop the new thingy and it works. The others don't know that this is happening. So I'm sorry, this is maybe small. The thing is that you have a picture upload, you send an image ID, image path, and user ID, maybe as JSON. There is a fan out exchange called upload pictures, and that's your user point queue. Then you can have a notify friends queue and a resize picture queue. Believe it or not, something similar like that works in Instagram. And they're processing, I think, 45,000 producers at the same time. They have six clusters with two nodes each. So the thing is, because you have a fan-out exchange, the producer has no idea that even if there is one of them or not, if there are the three or not, if giving points to user, like people think that's useless, you can just kill that consumer and that queue, the other two won't even notice that. And what's the code? Of course, you need to declare the exchange. In this case, it will be a fan-out exchange. You have some JSON data there. And you send the message. I mean, create a new message and do basic publish. It's exactly the same as before. And if you use Symfony, I have a bundle called RabbitMQ bundle, which basically wraps all these patterns, because what do you really care from here? You care that you have an exchange with some type and that you want to send it there. You don't want to be creating connections and channels and whatnot. So this bundle takes care of this part. And there is a library which was like the grandfather of that bundle, which I don't maintain, only for pull requests, and people still using it. So if you don't have Symfony and have like plain PHP, that library has these patterns as well. But it's not as developed as the bundle. And the consumer, again, declares the exchange, declares the queue, do the binding, basic consume, and get the stuff. I mean, it's really that simple what you do and how you work with Rabbit. One detail, that why it's called declare and not create in exchanges and queues, because this operation won't change if you call it many times. If the queue is there, it will be a no op, and if the queue is not there, it will be created. In that MySQL PHP 4 thingy, we will be checking, is the table there? No, then declare the table, and no. And a consumer can be like a function that takes the message will have a body, you do the decode, you call resize picture, and then the message in the delivery info has a channel that is the channel that was used to receive that message, where you will do basic ACK. And then in the info, you also have a delivery tag, which matches the message, so Rabbit knows which message you are ACKing, basically. So basically, that's what most consumers will be doing. Also, with this channel, it's not here, but you can grab the channel and publish a new message. So if you need to do like a pipes and filters pattern, this consumer can be saying, I'm done with the resizing, send a message so you can do whatever. That is also possible from there. You can also do a RPC style communication, the same using that channel and replying back to whoever sent the message. There are properties on this delivery info that can tell you who sent the message, provided the sender set that info on the message. So that's the code. And then logging, the stuff I mentioned before. You have many web servers. You have the logic separated by module action. Many log levels. And you want to add remote log listeners at will. So whenever you send a message like server1.home.index.info, this queue here says server1.hash. That means any message that comes from server1, it will go there. The next message, which says server2.home.index.error, will only go to this queue because it's hash.error. That means send me any error produced in the system. But if you say server1.user.profile.info, it will go to server1.hash, to star.user.hash, because as long as it comes from the user module, it will go there. And this one, as long as it comes from the user module and the profile controller, it will be there. And the last one is about having errors, and also from the server one. And you can see, because it says profile here, but here it says user.profile, this one doesn't match there. Again, same thing. The only difference is the exchange is a topic exchange. Send a message and use a routing key, preferably with the open quote here so it compiles, but that's a detail. And yeah, message, exchange, and routing key. Get the messages sent by the host server one. You declare the exchange, declare the queue, and in the binding, third argument, you say, you specify the binding key. If you want to get all the error messages on the binding, you do hash.error. Any questions from here? Okay, so the last example is distributed applications. Let's say you have something like that. Maybe it's too clear, but it's a map of the world with applications running in different Amazon zones. Oh. So you want to get all the data there on the states. The solution, the most simple solution you can have, is to have a process that consumes data from the queues and start sending it to the remote server. Some issues you can have with this approach is what happens if the remote server is offline. How do you prevent unbounded local buffers? You have a queue that cannot send the messages out and it's growing and growing and growing. How do you prevent message loss? What happens if you have a network partition and there was a message in flight there? How do you know? How do you prevent that you don't replicate messages that are actually not needed there, maybe not anymore? How do you synchronize all these states? What if the messages are actually stale? They are not relevant anymore on the faraway location. When you think about doing something like that, sooner or later, you will have these problems. Is there a better way to do that? In Rabbit, there is federation. Federation is a plugin I mentioned before that you can just enable, and magically, this will work. There will be rabbits in boats going around the ocean with messages. And what is this federation? It will give you replication across different administrative domains, so you don't really need to have the same rights everywhere. You can mix Erlang and RabbitMQ versions. It has support for network partitions. And not everything has to be federated. So you can decide which exchanges are federated or which queues are federated. You can do something like that, having one server, which is called upstream server, and many downstream servers that are getting messages from the one. Think about this concept of upstream like in a river. The upstream is the one is flowing data to the downstream. So data goes in this direction. You can also do stuff like that. Have a cycle where you replicate all the messages. And you can tell the federation plugin that max hops will be 5. So you don't have like a loop going forever there. This is just all just a configuration value when you declare a federated exchange. So it's a plugin. Internally, it just uses queues and exchange decorators. That's some internal implementation detail. And it's managed using parameters and policies. What's that? How do you enable this plugin or any plugin in Rabbit? You just say, RabbitMQ plugin, this is a command. Enable, name of the plugin. Like the management one I showed before, it was RabbitMQ, enable RabbitMQ management. You can have a management part of this plugin, so you can also have a tab on this other plugin where you can browse what this is doing. And then you will set one parameter, which the parameter type is federation upstream. You will give it a name like my upstream. And then the actual value will be a JSON object specifying the way to connect to Rabbit. And in this case, for example, expires. That means if this queue that you created for doing federation, that Rabbit will create automatically for you, is not used in 1 hour, it will be deleted. Once you got that parameter, you set a policy. So you will tell that all the exchanges that start, the name of the exchange starts with AMQ dot. It could be my shard, my images, or whatever you want to have there as a name. Plus telling use this federation upstream set to connect. Those are details. I won't explain them right now, but basically it's telling this stuff I set here, use it to connect. And plus like expires or max hops or message TTL, I think, and some other stuff. And that's that. Your application that was sending messages locally to the local cluster has no idea that this happened. The application on the remote server has no idea that this stuff happened. When you just enable that on the downstream server, Rabbit will do all the connections so you start getting messages from the upstream server. Internally, this is kind of how it works. you have an upstream exchange, the federated downstream exchange, your application was just sending messages there, and you have queues with bindings getting messages from that exchange. That was the normal configuration. And on the upstream server, you also had a queue and some publishers sending messages to the exchange. That was the what was there. When you told this exchange to be federated, basically Rabbit created like a ghost queue there in the background. That queue started getting messages also from the exchange and republishing them here. Because Rabbit has acknowledgments, you can tell the federation plugin that the messages from this queue are deleted only when this broker confirms that it received the message. That, of course, will be the slowest way, because this thing will wait for confirmation. But Rabbit, of course, will do optimization, will send messages in batch, like by default, I don't know if it's 2,000 messages or something like that. Another way, which is a bit faster, is delete the messages from this queue once they are published. Once they went out, you don't care anymore. They can be deleted. And the fastest version is no acknowledgement. That means as soon as the messages can be fetched from that queue, they will be deleted and fetched and shipped to the other server. If something breaks in between, you told Rabbit that you don't care, basically. Questions from this? Yes? In the last version, the limit got to 2 gigabytes, I think.
Per message,
yes. Ah, yes, yes. So there are many questions.
Yeah.
First question is what protocol Rabbit is using. It's using mostly NQP, or you can use MQTT or the other, or STOMP. That means the messages, depending on the protocol, will be encoded in that protocol binary or not, or text format. RabbitMQ is completely agnostic about what you publish inside the message. It doesn't really care if it's JSON, XML, plain text, a dump of a binary from an image, doesn't care. That is completely, it won't check. It's just the message headers. It's like really like the post office. Or what the post office should do is to never open your envelope, check where the message was sent, and put it there. That's all Rabbit is doing. Security, the port is 5672 by default, the ANQP port. I don't remember the ports of the other protocols. And then you have SSL support. And you have users with passwords. And when you publish a message, you can also have a property set on the message with a user ID. That means when Rabbit receives the message, if the user connected to Rabbit is not actually that particular user, it will discard the message, because you are trying to fake to be somebody else. So you have the user password when you open the connection, you have SSL connections, and then you have that other, like certify that the message came from that particular sender. Somebody first. Okay, here. I don't understand the question.
System, in which every node is a
publisher and customer, yeah?
What configurations, what implications would there be, like just normal?
I mean, it's made to work like that. So I'm not sure what's the actual question. Each consumer can have a its own queue. A queue will have a small footprint in memory because each queue is like a processing outline. You can have up to millions of processes in Erlang. You can just change the parameter when you start Rabbit and tell it to raise that limit. Of course, that depends on your memory on the broker. And that's that. Then Rabbit will just do the routing. You can read on the Rabbit blog about the performance of each exchange type, like the topic exchange is the slowest one, but still slow in messaging. We are talking about 20,000 or over 30,000 messages per second. So that's not what usually people think, this is slower or will Rabbit support a workload of 200 messages per second? That's like, it was made for higher loads. So overheads. Let me try to understand the question.
So if we're in context, for our application, we have 200-300 different vessels around the world, and we basically use a tungsten for Kona, where we distribute our entire MySQL database all over the entire fleet. This, of course, is a problem for us in regards to bandwidth. Bandwidth at sea is very expensive. So I'm thinking that we could use RabbitMQ only send information that we really need, not transferring all the tables row by row.
Like updates.
Yeah, it's very efficient as it is right now, but I think with this we could make it even more efficient if there's no heavy overhead on each of those messages. Because every time we send a record over, it will have to go through the 200 different ships at the same time, and if there's a big overhead on top of it,
Yeah, so the question is what is the overhead when distributed data and like distributed locations also?
Yeah.
He mentions also that MQTT could be a solution. MQTT is very good if you have intermittent connections that you can drop the connection.
Yeah.
That's made for that, actually.
Okay.
Per message, there is only a small overhead, like really, really small overhead. Because each message belongs to an index, because RabbitMQ doesn't duplicate message content. So when you send a message, it could end up in thousands of queues, but the content is stored only once and kept in memory only once. But so there is an index that knows where this message is on which queue. By default, Rabbit tries to keep all the data it can in memory. That's why Rabbit works better if you have like empty queues. So it's the full expression of queue in theory. The idea behind queue in theory is to not have any queues, actually, that you have as empty queues as possible. And Rabbit works in that way better. So anyway, if the message fits in memory, Rabbit will try to have this cache there and serve them from memory. If you tell Rabbit that you want to persist the message will be written to disk because that's what you asked for. And then the queues are just processes that they know they have messages, they know they have consumers, and then they do this kind of round robin trying to satisfy the requirement of the consumers. As a consumer, I didn't mention this, you can set a basic quality of service. Telling Rabbit, I want to have 10 messages, 100 messages, 1,000 messages. That Rabbit makes sure that delivers these many messages to that particular consumer before starting serving the next consumer. And this is very important if you, like in your case, if you measure the network latency, that you don't have a knack. So let's say you have 200 milliseconds of network latency, and you are sending a NAC per message. And you told Rabbit to send only one message at a time. So you have 400 milliseconds of wasted CPU there. So there is an algorithm called CodeDel, which is explained also in the Rabbit blog, on how to actually have a consumer that sets the right basic cost for the network latency that you have. So you try to maximize the waiting time in queue for the messages. So there are a lot of knobs, and we always advise that you just go to the mailing list of Rabbit, ask your question, present your use case. The Rabbit developers, the core team is replying there, so you will get the answer, and most probably the right answer, or just tell you, no, Rabbit cannot do that, because we don't want to be maintaining stuff that we, I mean, false promises, let's say. The question there? Yeah.
What is Rabbit offering that other ones are not? Or what would be a good reason to choose Rabbit versus RabbitMQ, Zero, Beanstalk, etc.?
Okay, the question is Rabbit versus the others.
Thank you.
Thanks. I couldn't get the message. Sorry. No. So where to start? I don't have much experience with the others, besides I only tried ActiveMQ when I was actually evaluating Rabbit. My evaluation was Rabbit versus ActiveMQ back in the days. For me, the advantage of Rabbit is all the clients that you have, the routing topologies that you have, the features I mentioned that you get out of the box, like all this kind of dead lettering or message TTLs, QTTLs, the different kind of clustering that you have, from like most basic clustering to be able to publish messages from to many servers in the cluster, up to mirror queues. Tell Rabbit, you can tell this message need to be replicated to every node in the cluster or only to two of them, or this amount of like a percentage. Then you have like the federation and so on. For me, that's like the killer feature is the amount of features that that it provides. And that is extensible. You can, if you know Erlang, you can extend, add new plugins, new ways of queuing, of routing, and so on. And then it's really, I'm not saying the others are not. I'm saying that Rabbit is really tested in production. It's used by a lot of users. You can check the Pivotal blog, actually, where we have a lot of use cases of people using Rabbit. And then the other one I know is ZeroMQ, but ZeroMQ is a library. The zero part in the name really means zero. That's something people get confused a lot, and they do a lot of Rabbit versus zero, but you're comparing a library with a broker. And ZeroMQ is a brokerless solution, kind of similar to what Federation will give you, and Rabbit is a broker-based solution. And if you read the book Enterprise Integration Patterns, at some point, both patterns are mentioned, and depending on your needs, on your scalability, on how many nodes you have, how many exchanges you have, if you have a brokerless solution, you will need to maintain all this routing and all the thing that the exchange is giving you for free. So that's my comment. Yeah. Wait, sorry, I'm kind of over time. So I need to finish. Yeah, last question.
So is a protocol server, does it mean that various clients can exchange the messages using different protocols? Like I send a message using A and B, but the other like consumer uses the other protocol?
Yeah. So the question is if you can mix protocols between consumers and producers? Yes. So to end up, sorry if the other speaker is here and I kind of got lost. So with Rabbit, you can get data using various protocols, NQP, MQTT, STOMP, HTTP, XMPP, and whatever ends in P, it seems. You can distribute data globally using Federation. You can scale using different consumer strategies, many consumers in one queue, many queues depending on how you put the exchanges and whatnot. You can integrate across many platforms and programming languages. question. I think we had them already. The talk, please rate them on LinkedIn, and you can find the link to the slides. So thanks.